This meeting is, yep, and as we intimated in the earlier session, this meeting is going to be recorded. So now we are getting into the recording mode. Once again, welcome to the second day session on the RISE testing track. I'm just sharing my screen. Please do let me know once you are able to view my desktop. Can one of you confirm you are able to view my desktop?
Yes, sir, we can.
Okay, sure, great, thank you. So this is about the RISE program and we are hosting this program to watch on a Women Who Code Hyderabad. So Women Who Code is basically a platform. It's a non-profit organization which basically supports the IT sector. I request that whoever is not speaking to please go on mute. So this is our mission, inspiring women to excel in the technology careers. And the vision is like a world where diverse women are people.
Your voice is breaking.
And actually, like when it comes to kind of voluntary platforms, there will definitely like code of conduct. So we request all the participants and then like who are the contributors, trainers, everyone, to ensure that they adhere to the code of conduct. And this is our chapter through which we are hosting the programs, Women Who Code Hyderabad chapter. Women Who Code is generally a worldwide.
Haris, sorry to interrupt. Your voice was breaking in between. Hari, can you hear me? I think Hari is having some internet issues. Just give him 5 more minutes. Can somebody confirm if I'm audible?
Yes, Rupanjali, you're audible.
Okay.
Yeah. Till Hari is back, let's have a quick recap. Can you all, anyone of you all, just give a one-liner for what is requirement?
Which we gathered from the client.
Okay. Who will gather the requirements?
Project manager.
Okay. What is the main characteristic of a tester?
Hey, Hari here. I joined back. Seems like I got disconnected.
Yes, Hari. Actually, since you are 2 minutes away, we thought we'll have some small quiz type. Yeah, please go ahead, Hari.
I think now Sirisha has been made the host. Sirisha, would you be able to record the session? Sirisha Yadav?
Yeah, I'm checking. You know, yeah, 1 second. I'll check.
Yeah. Yeah, even when you click like down, like there is one toolbar like share.
Yeah.
Chat. All that are there, right? In one of them, the recording option will be there.
Okay, just a second.
Yeah, yeah. Take your time. No problem.
It is session is already been recorded.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, great. It is under recording because I have only stop recording option. So I think it's getting recorded.
Great.
Yes, sir. Recording is on.
Sure, we'll continue then. Okay, glitch, and please confirm once you are able to make a stop.
Yes, we can, Hari.
Okay, yes. That's great. Yep. So I was just trying to explain like what the background of this particular organization and from which chapter this is being hosted. So we'll quickly move on. And prior to getting started with the second day session, maybe like I thought like we'll do kind of Q&A with respect to whatever the topics have been covered. So hope like everyone is able to see the first day session. Can one of you please know? Testing plan for Hyderabad RISE 2021. Are you at PPT?
Yes, we are able to view it.
Okay, so I thought about something known as quick five. So we just wanted to have some kind of quick quiz on like the topics that have been covered yesterday. So the first question for today is, what is the technology on which the first generation of computers were built? And I request the participants to use the chat option in the answers. The question is, what is the technology on which first generation computers were built? This is open for everyone. I request everyone to be engaging and interactive. There is no right or wrong answer. Please go ahead and provide your answers. Am I audible?
Yes, Hari, you are.
Great. Okay, Sri Stravani, yes, you are right, Sri Stravani, vacuum tubes. Okay. That's great. Moving on. The second question is, what is the most critical part of a computer? So out of the different kinds of utilities, like the structure itself, I'll just flash it for everyone.
Is it memory unit?
So out of this, like, which one is most critical? Please give a try, another try. Yeah, someone answer. Yes, it's the CPU, central processing unit. Okay. And then, can someone define application software? What is application software? Please feel free to go ahead and refer the material also which was processed today. Just try to respond to this question.
Hi, it's Neha here. Application softwares are used in various sectors where it may be a business or any marketing strategy purpose or banking or healthcare.
Definitely. Great, Neha. Thank you. Thanks for that response. And the last one is like yesterday, Vishal actually explained about two different types of testing. Can someone help? What are
the? It's manual testing and automation testing.
Great. Yes, I think like we are good with that. So thanks everyone for participating in this quiz. So this is about the content that we have covered yesterday. We just try to cover the evaluation, how exactly like the computers of the earlier generations were there, on which technology, and then we try to understand the classification by type, and then by size, and then use. And at the same time, like we try to understand like what is hardware and software. And finally, like we try to understand like the operating system, networking, internet, data and information technology, and the features of programming. So prior to jumping on to today's session, does the audience have any kind of questions with respect to whatever we covered yesterday? So if you feel like you don't want to take them up on the forum, please feel free to reach out to the trainers on their WhatsApp. And definitely, like we are going to help you. Okay. With that, I think like we are good to get started with today's session. So I would like to introduce the trainer. Today's trainer is Vishal Akshi. She got overall 14 years of experience and she's an expert both on manual and as well as like automated testing. With that, I would like to hand over the control to Vishal. Yeah, Vishalakshmi.
Yeah, thank you, Hari. Hi all, a very good morning. Welcome back to our day two session. Okay, so yesterday we were talking about requirements, manual testing, what is actually meant by manual testing. So today we would like to cover the basic things in testing, like what is quality? When we hear the word testing, what comes into our mind? Okay. We always think quality of the product. Quality of the product, how does it come? When we do the testing, we need to do testing of the quality of the product. So today we would like to define what is meant by quality, what is the cost of quality, so different basic testing vocabulary we would like to cover, and what is the need of testing. Hari, I lost your slide share, Hari.
You are, Visha.
Panchali, I am unable to see the slides actually.
Okay. One moment. Let me check.
Meanwhile, I'll just be continuing. Let Hari share it on the back end.
Yeah.
So, okay. Thanks, Rupanjali. Okay. So, when we are talking about quality, what does actually quality mean? Any one of you? What comes to your mind when we say the word quality?
Defect free.
Okay. Any other term for it? One is the exact testing word someone has given. Thank you for it. Any other term that comes to your mind when you say quality of a product?
Yeah, it's a standard at which a product is manufactured or developed to meet the requirements, to meet certain type of requirements.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much for the detailed thing. So that whole sentence, which one of our friend has explained, in one word, if we tell, it is fitness for use. So the client has given you some requirement and we are trying to develop that product, and then we are going to deliver that product. At the end of end of the day, the main aim is that product should be ready for use, fitness for use. So in testing terms, when we say quality, one of the experts from testing named Joseph Juran, he termed it as quality is nothing but fitness for use. Okay, so suppose if we have manufactured a product, and they have asked us to develop a mobile application. But instead of developing a mobile application, we have delivered a gaming application. So will it be successful? No, not. But the end of the day, we are telling it's an application. So instead of mobile application, I have delivered a gaming application. But that is not the intent. I wanted a mobile application. So over there, the quality of the product is null. It's zero, because gaming application is different and a mobile application is different. So a person cannot use it as a mobile application. So it is not fit for use for that person. So quality is nothing but end of the day, it should be used successfully. Whatever the client has asked, that particular product should be delivered with that quality. Okay, am I clear? Any questions?
Yes,
over
Visha.
Here? Okay. I'm not sure if you're not able to view the content because I'm not able to view it from my side, but we will send it across the PPT later on to you all. Okay.
I'm trying to share, Visha. It's saying it's not supported. Give me 2 minutes. In the meantime, you just continue. I'm just trying to share.
Rupanjali, if not, I'll try to share here.
If you can just try. For me, it is saying unsupported document.
Okay. I'll try to share it. Give me a second.
Okay.
And let me know once you all are able to see it.
Yes, we can, Visha. Thank you.
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, fine. So the first, we have the defined quality. Any confusion over here, friends? Anybody has any question on it? Okay, if there are no questions, I would go with the next definition of quality. Okay, there's another great expert called Philip B. Crosby, and he has told quality is nothing but conformance to requirements. So we have covered in our example even this, that we are trying to deliver what is given in the requirement document. So that is also termed as quality. So at the end of the day, quality is nothing but quality of a product or service is its ability to satisfy the needs and expectations of the customer. Okay. So let me explain you all some theory behind quality. Okay, there were three experts, okay, called as Deming and Joseph Girard and Philip B. Crosby. These three people, they had some expertise in testing and they had some theory on quality, and it was called as Total Quality Management, TQM. Okay, this TQM concept is nothing but they have taken some other theory, but I am trying to give you all an example using a wedge sandwich. Okay, so Joseph Juran and Deming, both of them, what they did is, okay, what they tried to analyze, okay, this wedge sandwich, why is it not getting, why am I not getting profit for it? Why are the sales going down? What should be done in order to get more profit in a less time? How should I deliver it? So all they have done it on burger, but I am giving you all a wedge sandwich example over here. So they first try to analyze what is the breadth, everything of the bread, which quality of the bread I need to use in order to get good customers for me. Which suppliers I need to go ahead. So they try to take a survey with the suppliers also in order to understand what is the requirement. So similarly, in our testing need, we need to understand from the requirement from the clients, what is their actual requirement. In order to get the requirement document done, they will also go to the suppliers. So the same way, Deming, Juran and Crosby, three of them, they went to suppliers, they did the survey and they understood, okay, my sandwich, my bread quality should be in this way. This is the cost I need to put for it in order to reach it to everyone. It should be $2. It shouldn't be more than $2. The amount I'm investing is so much. I'm expecting so much of profit. So all these analysis they have done. So as part of our testing also, when a requirement is being given, we need to do a good requirement analysis. Yeah, please let me know if I'm trying to go a little bit faster. I'm just trying to correlate things and make you all understand. Is the pace okay, friends?
Yes, it's fine.
Okay, yeah, thank you. So now these three people have gone and to the suppliers, they did the survey and they understood, okay, what is the quality of the bread I need to use? What are the ingredients that needs to be placed in it for a better taste? So in our testing process, we need to understand what are the tools that I can use. Okay, when they are talking about the ingredients over there, for my requirement, the client and as a team, we need to understand what are all the different flavors I need to put in order to get the best result. So similarly, these three people have identified like what are the ingredients in order to get a good taste. After that, they again thought, okay, the next step is resources. How many resources I need to place in over there? Similarly, in our testing team, once we have the different tools in place, we need to know how many resources should work on which requirement. We shouldn't have more resources and a small requirement. So similarly, in order to have, because if we have more resources and less work, okay, at the end of the day, we are not going to get profit out of it. But at the end of the day, as an organization, we are looking at the quality of the product and the profit for the investment we have put in. Okay, so these people have also looked into their resources. The second thing is like, how are my resources skilled? Are they skilled perfectly to prepare this sandwich? So the training that is required, what are the tools that are required in order to get the sandwich done properly? At what time it should be grilled? At which layer the cheese or the vegetables need to be placed in? That this refers to, in our testing life cycle, at which place which documents need to be done, at which place I need to review it, at which place I need to send a document, write the test cases, where, at which phase I need to do planning. So similarly, these people have come up with a nice name called as plan, do, act and check. I'm again reiterating, plan, do, check and act. Okay, so they have, using that experiment, they have come up with this cycle, PDCA. Okay, so they have planned well, okay, what are the things that are required and all, and they have put into action, and if something is going wrong, they have put the controls over there. Okay, this particular resource is not able to do this perfectly fine, so let me train him. So there are some controls over there, and also auditing. Okay, is it going fine or not? Something is not going on correctly, they try to do the improvements also over there, quality improvements. So checking, doing, again, the project managers are acting on it. So all this put together, at the end of the day, the quality has been measured. So at the end of the day, we are delivering a quality product. Okay, it is a big theory, but I try to sum up within short span of time. So you all need to just understand what is meant by quality of a product and what these three people came together and defined. They told, we need to have a better quality, greater productivity in the sense, not many resources doing a less amount of work. Okay, having skilled resources giving a good productivity. And after delivering the product, the customer should be happy, and everybody as an organization, as a team, everybody who has delivered the product should be happy. So this was the theory by Demings, Juran and Philip B. Crosby. So three terms over here reiterating. Okay, one is fitness for use, the product should be accurately fine, that is defect free, as one of my friends told, it should be ready to be used. As soon as Zomato is delivering, it is like, how, you are not cooking or nothing, it is directly, we need to go serve, have it. So like that, fitness for use. Okay, then conformance to the requirements. Whatever you have ordered in Zomato, is that coming or not? If something else is coming, you are not a happy customer. So Philip B. Crosby is telling, it should be conformance to the requirements. Okay, am I clear? I'll pause a while over here. Please let me know if any issues or anything. I wanted you all to understand what is quality. Are we good, friends? Any questions to me or anything? Any feedback over here? Am I audible?
It is quite clear, Vaishali.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much. So we will be sending this PPT to you all. So this is all theory, but only in our head, we need to have the basic terms. Okay. Like, what is quality? Now let's go to our next topic. Okay, why is that we need to do testing? Okay, why are we required? Okay, the first thing, let me explain you all. Usually in the olden days, the developers who only used to develop and they used to test their code. But always remember, a person who codes himself cannot identify his own mistakes. We need always another pair of eyes to look into the code. That is the reason the tester's role has come into existence. Okay, so what are the most common software problems? Okay, the incorrect calculation, if there is incorrect calculation, suppose we are using some banking application only. By mistake, if I put in place of two zeros, if I put five zeros and get it credit done to a third party person, then that's if the application is working in that, if the coding is done like that, and if we did not do testing, then imagine like what should the bank do after 1 year down the line if every time the three zeros are being added instead of two zeros. Adding to the two zeros, three more zeros for it. So that is why our role is so critical as a quality control specialist. Okay, so there are many examples like why actually a tester is required. Okay, so I hope we are all here for this course, so we know what is our role and why are we so important in the IT industry. As I was telling yesterday, what is the main idea that as a tester we should have? We all should have, yesterday I spoke about a term called as happy path. Okay, so we should have a mindset first, to define the happy path. Once the happy path is done, the second most important thing is, what are all the positive scenarios and the negative scenarios that we need to test? Why are we doing that? Is, we should have an intention to find an issue in the application. At any cost, at least a minor issue needs to be found out with the tester. Then only he or she is the best QA. There will be at least one miss from the developer here. At least one small, if you take a browser testing or anywhere, one small miss will be there. So we all should be thinking in those angles with different scenarios and try to test it such that the application should break down. Okay, so once we are having that mindset in our mind, then only we can deliver an application which is fit for purpose, that is, which is a quality product. Next thing is the second most important objective of testing is as we already told during the initial start of the session, that we are trying to see whatever requirements are given, is the requirement being fulfilled successfully, and whatever environment that is expected to work on, it is working or not. As I took an example in the initial past 10 minutes back, they asked me to develop a mobile application, but I developed a gaming application. I thought application and a mobile means okay, some application like that. But that gaming application is different and mobile application is different. Gaming application cannot work as a mobile for me. So that is what meant by intended environment. In which environment, which application should work, that also should be perfectly validated. If I want one of the particular application to work on Chrome, that needs to be working on Chrome. If it needs to work on Mozilla or the Firefox or IE, that has to work on different environments successfully. Okay. Since we are talking about different browsers, let me introduce you all to a term called as cross-browser testing. When we tell cross-browser testing, it means when a requirement is given to you all, as a tester, you always need to validate whether this application is working on multiple browsers or not. Nowadays, they don't define saying that this application should work in this environment. It should be compatible with all the browsers. That is what is called cross-browser testing. Fine. Am I clear till here? Can I go ahead?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Now, in order to do a good testing, what is the requirement? Okay. I cannot in AS think something and go ahead and test. Okay. If I do like that, then I will go ahead and create a gaming application only instead of a mobile application. Instead of when I order in Zomato dosa, they will give me burger. If I don't have a plan or if I don't have any set of guidelines, okay, these are the issues that happen. So that is the reason we need to have a good test case. Okay, that test case should be in such a way that it should discover errors. Okay, any error that cannot be seen to our eyes also should be, we should be able to discover those errors with our test cases. That is what is meant by good test cases. And that characteristic, a tester will only have it. That is what we are telling. On a 360 degree angle, we need to focus, think about all the different scenarios. Okay, now let me stop for 1 minute and ask you all a question. Okay, any one of y'all, my product is a pen. Okay, I am asking you all to test it. Any one of y'all, can you give me a one good test case for it? Just for 2 minutes, we'll just pause over here. And please think about a good test case and give it to me. And okay, if some of y'all might not aware, test case means nothing but a scenario. Just what will you test in it? In order to see if it is working fine or not, that
is. Ma'am, can you repeat the question?
Yeah, sure. I am asking, my product is a Reynolds pen. Okay. I am asking you all to tell me one test case that should discover an error in it. You should identify a defect in it. Okay, somebody has given you a pen.
It should be smooth to hand, should write properly. The cap should fit to the body. Am I right?
Yeah, yes. These are different test cases for it. Okay, yeah, thank you so much.
Yeah.
Fine. Anybody wants to add anything?
Yeah. How soon it gets dried up once we write a word or a sentence, once we start writing?
Yeah, good. Yeah, very nice. Yeah. So thinking in different angles is, this is what is called as a tester, writing different scenarios. Positive, negative. Okay, so I'm not sure like who has told, that is the way of thinking, like, how fast it is getting dried up, that the negative scenarios, how many pages can I write with this pen. Okay, yeah, thank you. So these are all our objectives of testing. And thing is, like, always do not make too complex your test cases. It should be very simple. Okay, if you have a complex test case, always break it down. Okay, do not have 50 steps in one test case. It's better always break down your test cases, simplify them. Okay, we are all covering now manual testing only. I'm not talking about automation anywhere. Okay, that's the reason I'm telling manual test cases. Okay, now say an example. If I try to take the pen example itself, I don't want you all to write the test cases as one of my friends told. See whether the cap is fitting properly or not. See how the grip is, like how are we able to hold it. So each of them should be one of your scenario, not one single test case. Okay, have 3 different test cases for it. I don't want one test case with all the features of the pen in it. And for example, take the latest one, which one of your friend told that whether I'm able to write one word and is the ink getting dried up. So in that scenario, in that test case, you can tell, okay, if I, how many pages is it going on? How many words it is getting calculated? So your scenario would be like, validate whether how many pages the pen can be written. The ink, the validate whether the ink is getting dried up with 500 words. And then you can have four steps in it. So this is how you should write your test cases. Anyways, we have another session for test cases and all. Just I'm trying to give you all here and there the little bit intro for test cases also. Okay, yeah. Friends, is it fine? Am I going in good pace or any feedback over here? Please stop me and let me know. In between, you all can add on. Like Visha, you all can call me Visha, and you all please stop me if it is, if I'm going a little bit fast or something. Please let me know. And if you all are not able to understand any of the terms, you all can stop me. Yeah. Till now, how is it, friends? Is it going on fine?
Yeah, it is fine. Just one question from my side. So how many test cases it can be for any particular product?
Okay. See, it depends on the product. I'm not sure who's talking. Sorry, I'm not able
to. It's Snehal.
Okay. Yeah. Hi, Snehal. Snehal. See, it depends on the application and the time duration being given to you. Suppose there is a product that I need to do deliver in 2 days of time. Okay.
Okay.
It is very critical. So you as a tester, you need to understand, like, should I write 100 test cases and I have only 2 days of time? Okay, 2 days of time is nothing but per day you have 8 hours. It's only 16 hours in your hand. And it is a very complex application. Right. Okay, so will you write 100 test cases for it? In 2 days of time, you need to cover the entire application. So it depends on the situation, in which environment you are checking, what is the deadline you have. So at this situation, as a tester, you need to pick up all the critical functionalities. So if the critical functionality, you have 100 test cases for an application. Think it is IRS, railways IRST site only. So it can come 100 test cases, but within 2 days, can we do 100 test cases manually? Yeah. Not possible. So, and you have to deliver it at the end of the day, second day. So you need to pick up all the critical functionalities, the major critical 10 test cases, thoroughly test them.
Okay, fine.
So that depends on the situation.
Okay, okay. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Fine. Can I go ahead? Any questions?
Yes.
Next, as a software tester, we all need to identify bugs as early as possible and make sure they get fixed. Why are we telling this statement? Okay, suppose as Nehal told, okay, within 2 days I'm going to test the application. Till the second day, I did not find out a defect. I need to give a sign off. Okay, first day I simply tested whatever is there, second day also I tested. In end moment, at the last 16th hour, I am finding a big critical issue. Like when I try to log in the details, I am entering the payment details and all, but the ticket is not getting successfully done. And that is a major issue. Application only is not stable. Okay, it is, after I click on the payment details, it is giving me server error. Okay, and on the nth moment, if I try to find out that bug, okay, because I did not test till the second day, the second page. I was first day testing only the login page only. I did not go until the last page, till the payment details and all. So it is a total flop show. We cannot deliver the product. So it is always, we should keep in our mind, find out the bugs as early as possible. Okay, whatever bugs are there, try to do a smoke testing. Okay, now since we have there is another term that I'm introducing to you all, just note it down, a smoke testing. Smoke testing is nothing but as soon as an application is released, a build is released, the developer has developed it and they have given you all for testing. So as a tester, you need to do the smoke testing. Smoke testing is nothing but you are trying to test on a high level all the features. Features are nothing but functionality of the application. Is it working fine? Am I getting internal server error? Internal server error is nothing but, I know few of them might know over here because they are experienced, but for the few of my freshers, new friends and all, server error is nothing but as soon as you open suppose you think Facebook only, you are trying Facebook or any shopping Amazon site, you clicked on something, it gave you internal server error. Now you cannot do anything over there. It's totally down, site is down. So that is nothing but the internal server error. Okay, so we need to identify when as soon as the application is build is deployed, we need to do all these mandatory checks. We are not asking you to do the thorough testing of the application, just on a high level. Are you able to navigate from one page to another? For example, you take the same Amazon site. Like, is the user able to log in successfully? The first step. Second step, okay, if the user is trying to click on add to cart by selecting any product, is it successful or not? Third step, if I'm able to go to the payment step and able to enter details and do the payment successfully, yeah, fine. That's it. I am not checking any other options over there. Is the kitchen utensils, everything getting displayed, or is I'm able to select each of the vessels, each of the utensils over there? Is the women's kids, everything? I'm not checking. Only one functionality per page. Navigation from one page to the other page is successful or not is called as smoke testing. You shouldn't get any internal server over there. Okay. Fine, friends. I introduced two terms over here, which is not in our content. One is smoke testing and the other one was cross browser testing. And I also today gave some intro to test cases. So these three are not in today's session, but little bit overview of them. So are you all good with these three terms? Smoke testing, cross browser testing, and little bit on test cases. Fine, friends. Any doubt over here?
No, from my side.
Okay. Anyone else would like to share anything? Can I continue?
Hey, please feel free to shoot out any questions if you have, actually, so that Visha can proceed.
I'm not sure who was talking, but I heard it as you want to know cross browser testing. Like, I will take 1 minute now and I'll explain her. But later on, again, we will have this different types of testing.
Okay, sure.
I don't know. I'll explain you in one liner. Cross browser testing is nothing but, see, now I want my Amazon to work on all the browsers. Okay, suppose I, Vishalakshi, would be using IE, Internet Explorer. Now my friend Hari would like to use it on Chrome. So he doesn't have IE in his system. He wants that Amazon website to be opened on Chrome. Now Snehal wants to use it on Firefox. Okay, so we all want to use them on different. Now newly we have Edge. So another, my friend Rupanjali wants to use it on Edge Node. So this is nothing but cross browser testing. Like, on all the browsers, my application should work successfully. It shouldn't throw an error. That is what, at the end of the day, the customer is happy and able to log in and get the sales done. If it's opening only on Chrome, then some customers will be like, I don't have Chrome, I don't want to install Chrome now. Means I am losing a customer over there. So that is why whenever an application is being developed, we try to do this cross-browser testing also. All the applications should be tested on all the browsers. Okay, fine. Can I proceed?
Yes, please. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay, now let's go to verification and validation. This is another basic terminology in testing we use. Okay, always people will be, well, might be hearing people telling VNV. Okay, VNV is nothing but verification and validation. Verification is nothing but, okay, as a part of the testing team, we are having some process documents everywhere. Quality assurance. I'm trying to explain you here, even quality assurance. Okay. Like when we say quality assurance and verification, in QA process, we will have every step, each and every step, we have some documents in place. We need to follow them as our standards. That is nothing but verification. Whenever I am trying to write test cases, I will not write something in some Excel sheet or some Word document or nothing. There is a standard template for test cases. I need to follow that. Okay. Without following the template, I shouldn't do that. That is against the policy. You need to adhere to the policies. Like there are some standards, we need to follow them. So what we are doing in verification is every step, when we are doing test planning, we have a test plan template. You need to go according to that only. When the developers are coding, they write according to the coding standards. When it comes to requirements, there is a requirement specification document. It cannot be a normal Word document. The requirement should be specified according to the template. We call it as a specification requirement document or the user requirement document. I will later on explain them. So every step has a specific standard thing. Okay, so we need to follow them. That's it. So what we are doing in verification is we are trying to see whether we are following them, and we are verifying at each step if we are doing according to that standard or not. After I writing the test cases, I will have a checklist. Okay, according to this checklist, we literally follow this checklist and all. If this process is not followed, we will be failing in the audit. We need to show all these documents in the audit. Okay, in this testing life cycle, we follow all these templates. That is, at every step, we are trying to verify. As soon as I write my test cases, I try to see, okay, did I follow the testing case template? Okay, what is the next step in that? I need to send it for review. Did I follow the review process document or not? Did I send it correctly to my peer to review? Did I send it to my on-site coordinator to review? So, did I walk through the test cases with all of my team members and with my business team member to get an approval? So verification is nothing but at every step, you are trying to follow the standards and you are doing your activities. Okay. Am I clear here, friends, before I move on to validation? Hello?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yes. Hello.
Yeah. Yes. Yes.
Actually, I have one doubt. Like, in this, are we doing only like a critical test, or we have to follow all the tests in verification part?
See, in verification, you will not be doing any testing. Verification is only, there are some standard templates and all. Okay, for example, do not laugh, okay? I'm just trying to give you all some cooking thing. If you need to prepare dosa, okay, And I think for my outside friends, there is a cuisine. I'm trying to explain her to prepare one food. Okay, there is an item called dosa. In order to prepare dosa, you have some standards. I need to put only 2 glasses of rice. I need to put 1 glass of urad dal for it. Okay, so you are not doing anything. You are just, you have the standard measurement over there. You will just validate what you're putting over there. Okay, the measurement. Okay, you are not doing anything, no testing how dosa is being tasted, how is the dosa coming. You are not doing anything. It's only the standard measurement. Okay, whenever I have to prepare dosa, this is my standard template. I need to put 2 glasses of water, 2 glasses of rice with 1 glass of urad dal. So you always compare with it. Yes?
Okay.
No preparation, nothing. Just validating with it means verifying, okay, this I have put or not, is it in the place, I'm not putting more than that. Okay, actual testing comes in validation. Okay, you have a checklist. Okay, in order to do this dosa, you have a checklist. Okay, I need to put all these quantities accurately. That is your verification part. Validation is our part. That is the main role. We are trying to do the testing and we are trying to find the defects over there. So verification is nothing but you are following the processes document. It is only trying to make sure that you are not going to produce a defect product. Okay, defective product. It is giving you some standard processes. But validation is nothing but you are testing it thoroughly. That means you are trying to prepare the dosa, put it on the stove. Is it coming perfectly fine or not? With whatever batter you have prepared, in validation, you are trying to put the batter on the stove and see the taste, everything. Is it coming crispy or not? So validation, you are actually testing. You are trying to identify the defects. Okay, got it? Yes. Okay. Yeah. Now for the rest of my teammates, actually I just wanted her to be clear, so I used that example. Now for rest of my friends, okay, verification is nothing but you have a standard documentation, template, processes everywhere. You have to go according to that when you're trying to write your test cases or when you're trying to plan, do some reviews. Okay, so over there, our main aim is we are trying to see that we are not going to deliver a defective product. In validation, you're trying to test the product and identify the defects to get them fixed. We do the actual testing in validation. You will try to break the code in validation, not in verification. In verification, you're trying to write your test cases and all according to the standards so that in validation, when you try to actually do the experiment or do the testing, it should produce you wherever there are defects. Usually defects shouldn't come, but you are trying to do a thorough testing. So your testing is nothing but your validation. Am I clear, friends?
Yes.
Okay. So after we follow these processes, at the end of the day, it should be a defect-free product. In validation, we try to identify the defects. We go to the developer and we try to get them fixed. Okay. This defect life cycle also we'll try to cover in the next session. Today we just wanted to cover the software development process life cycle and also different terms of quality, as I told. Okay, before going to software after VNV, let me explain one software development process cycle, which I already told. Deming has come up with this approach: plan, do, check, and act. Okay, see, planning is, let us take the same example of the food. Like, you're planning what needs to be prepared for my morning breakfast. Okay, what should be that is what you're planning, how should it be. Doing is, you're trying to perform it. Means you are trying to do your breakfast, means preparing the breakfast. Planning is just planning. Tomorrow, what should I do? When you are doing this, you are trying to do the breakfast. Check means when you are doing the breakfast, when you are trying to prepare the breakfast, if there are any inconsistency of if the taste is not, if the look and feel is not good, you try to check it and you try to correct it. That is nothing but your quality control improvements. Okay, so you are trying to check it and you are trying to correct it. And then again, you're so before serving it to your family members, you're if any action needs to be done, like taste and all, so you're doing the action, and then at the end of the, once it looks good for you, then only you will deliver it to your family members. So I just try to give you all a normal example here. So plan, do, check, action. Okay, now let's go to the actual testing thing. So plan means you are having a test plan in your mind. When the product is being given to you, you are devising a plan. A test plan is being prepared. What is my objective for this particular requirement? How should I test it? What are the methods I need to go ahead with it? Should I do a manual testing over here? Should I do automation testing over here? So all is being done in planning phase. Okay, so plan, you will understand now. What is meant by planning? Should I pause for a minute over here? Is it going beyond sense? Hello, am I audible?
Yes, Visha. Participants, please confirm your acceptance or like if you have any questions, please feel free to ask them. So this is just like the normal activities which we do anyway as part of any particular implementation. So first we'll just plan our things. For example, tomorrow I need to host a session, right? So I will do like, okay, my planning. What is the timing? When do I really need to do that? And then like when the time happens, like when the clock ticks the time, I will just go ahead and do it. And then post doing that, definitely I will go ahead and check like, okay, what all things went fine and what would be the areas of improvement for me to improve upon. And then like we'll act on whatever the different action items that we have identified. So this is a simple life cycle, which can be applied to any project or any kind of activity or any kind of task. So Deming is a person like who has come up with this particular approach. Any thoughts, questions you would like to hear from the audience, their voice? Is it becoming too high or too much to absorb?
No, it's fine.
Excuse me, ma'am. Hello?
Yeah, yes.
This is Sweta, ma'am.
Yeah.
Actually, can we validate without verification or both are interlinked always?
You cannot go without verification, Shweta. See, without putting the correct quantity of the measurements for dosa, will the dosa come properly? You tell me.
No.
So always we need to follow the standard process. If not, if you don't follow verification, what will happen is the product will not be good. It will not come crispy. It will, for the stove only, it will go everything. For the tawa, it will get sick. Okay, so always we need to follow processes, na? If processes are in place only, our product will be defect-free.
Okay.
So always you need to do verification and then do your validation. Okay. Yeah, I'm sorry, like if my outside friends are, I was just trying to give Indian cuisine which we use it over here. It is similar to your breakfast items in other places, friends. Yeah. Okay, can I go ahead here or friends, is it going beyond? Please let me know if my pace is a little bit faster. Should I go, if I should go a little bit slow? or else a little bit I can continue a little bit more faster. Any feedback is fine.
Visha, this is fine, I think, at least for me.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
Yeah, it's going good.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
I want to clarify that what I understood from plan, that considering the requirement, means from starting of the project requirement till the execution, whatever the instructions are there, so we have to plan in plan area. Till delivery of project, right?
Yeah, till the end of the delivery of the project, you need to create a document will be there called as test plan. Okay, so in
okay,
that
so set of instructions we are preparing here.
Yes, I said, yeah, you can tell us as of now, for your understanding, we will set of instructions, but when we'll be walking through your test plan, you all will be knowing the terminology, like what will be in that end. So as of now, you have in your mind, a plan is nothing but a set of instructions for you in order to deliver your product successfully. What is the strategy that you have in your mind?
Okay, fine, thank you.
Okay, yeah, thank you. Okay, friends, now let's go a little bit, ahead. So coming back to quality again, morning I explained to you all like what is the term quality, but in quality we have few things, okay, few more little bit theory part. Okay, I'll just take 5 minutes over here. So for quality, what is there is like there's something called as cost of quality. This is an important it is not for the testers, but as a tester we need to know these terms. But for the managers, for the management, for the for the organization, it is important. Okay, because any product we are delivering or we are developing, it involves cost. Okay, so at the end of the day, it is like how much amount we have put, how much return on investment we are getting. So end of the day, how much profit we are getting by delivering this product. Then only our daily routines, our job would be there. So we need to understand this cost of quality. Okay. So the first term, okay, cost of quality is nothing but you have three terms involved in it. One is prevention cost. Second one is appraisal cost. The other one is failure cost. Okay, now let me explain you all what is meant by prevention cost. Prevention cost is nothing but, see, I have a team of 4-5 people, okay, and I want to deliver a good mobile application, but I don't have my team good at testing, okay. I don't have a tool called as Appium for that mobile testing. So what I need to do is like, in order for my product to be delivered successfully without issues, I am trying to train my resources in that Appium tool. Okay, for my friends, Appium is a tool used for mobile applications testing. Okay, so I'm just using those terms and I'm trying to design you all also. So I want my testers to be good at that, so that because at the end of the day, it shouldn't be like, I don't know Appium tool. I'm a normal manual tester. So I don't know how to test mobile testing. You gave me one UI, I tested it with whatever knowledge I have. And if it goes with defects in market, what will be my situation? Okay, only some few people will buy it and in second month, I should close my industry. So that is why what the management does it, they try to, in their budget planning and all, they try to have some amount called as prevention cost. Prevention cost is nothing but the amount that I'm spending for my product to be delivered successfully with quality, the training that is being given, the amount that is the cost that has incurred on training or building, getting some tools for them. Okay, before the product is being developed, okay, we did not start anything. Before the product development has started, I have put some amount on the on few things like training, some tools, upskilling my resources. So that amount, that prevention cost, so that my quality is defect free. Okay, this is called prevention cost. Am I clear here, friends? What is meant by prevention cost? See, you all might be thinking, now as a tester, why do I need prevention cost, appraisal cost and all? See, initially we might be at a seen as like at a software engineer level, but later on, at least 2 years down the line, we will go to the next level. So we need to understand all these terms.
Visha, can you give a simple analogy or an example here, prevention cost ke liye?
I'm sorry,
you'll have to repeat it. I'm sorry.
No problem. It's fine. So I would take another example over here. I have a team member, I have a team who are only perfect in manual testing. They don't know any automation testing. Okay, but I want my product to be delivered within 1 month of time. Okay, and this manual testing team has done it already. They have done the testing already. Okay, now it needs to be repeated. It's a total like a regression testing. The application should be tested thoroughly. So at least per day, this application should be running 10 times. Okay, and I have only 2 testers in my team. And they don't know automation testing. Okay. And I don't want to go to any other tester because it is a complex application. And I cannot give KT a knowledge transfer and all. So what I'll do is like, I will try to train these people in automation testing. That is less cost for me instead of bringing new resources from somewhere. So what I'll do is like, okay, I will try to train 2 of them with 1 license. Okay, I'll try to buy 1 license. I'll give both of them. I'll try to train in automation testing slowly because manual testers will little bit less salary, means a little bit, it wouldn't cost more for me. So what I do is like, I try to train them in automation. So this cost which I'm putting for training them in automation is prevention cost. Okay, because I want to deliver the product successfully. If I tell these manual testers to do something, okay, done manually only 10 times, I will not use automation tool. What they will do, initial 2 days they will do, okay, 10 times they will try to run the same regression test. But third day, will they sit in the front of system and run it 10 times? They will get vexed up. They will like, oh, every day I'm doing the same job. I will run something, okay, yesterday I ran successfully, na? Today let me not run it. It will not, anyways, from past 5 years, I'm doing the same application. So I know what is working fine. Leave. Okay, to yesterday it ran. I will run tomorrow. Anyways, this whole month I need to run it. Sometimes it happens. It's a human intention.
Yeah. Definitely agree with you, Visha. Maybe like I will give another example also, just to add to that. So for example, like there is one company and the company name is ABC. So the ABC company right now, it is manufacturing desktops. Desktops are nothing but that we have a monitor and then we have a CPU box and a keyboard, everything. Now this company, it took a decision. It wanted to venture into manufacturing the laptops, okay? Some new product. So the first thing they need to do is like plan around the prevention cost. And when we say around the prevention cost, what is that is like, we need to think about what are the different costs that we need to spend in order to ensure that whatever the new product that is in this case, laptops, when we launch, they are sustainable in the market and we get a good amount of profit on them. So for that particular use case, I can think about the training that needs to be provided to these person who are working on the desktops manufacturing, because like right now they are experts on the desktop manufacturing, but they are not experts on manufacturing the laptops. So I need to train my human resources on that new skill set of manufacturing the laptops. And at the same time, I need to procure new set of tools or technologies which will enable me to do that manufacturing of the laptops. And at the same time, to test their functionality. So this kind of like something which can be thought well in advance before getting started with the actual implementation itself, that kind of cost, we are trying to call them as a prevention cost. So something which we want to avoid at a later point of time. All these examples like procedures, training the workers, acquiring the tools, and as well as planning for the quality. Does that help actually, the scenario or the use case that I just tried to describe?
Yes, I understand. It's like, you know, the cost that is incurred on the resources to upgrade or to train so that yes. we prevent the damage beforehand.
Yeah, yes, correct. We got this proverb, right? A stitch in time saves nine. So something if you do well in advance, at a later point of time, you may not really need to spend more efforts, more cost, more time on fixing them. Something which is in our control and which can be done immediately prior to the actual getting started of the project itself. Yeah, Vishal, please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you for that example. Yeah. So I hope now we are good with the prevention cost. Let's go ahead with appraisal cost. Okay. Appraisal cost is nothing but, see, we already trained our resources, everything done. They have already, they are delivered. Now they are trying to use the automation tool and they are trying to deliver it every day. But before delivering, what they are doing is like, they are trying to, whatever new technology they have used, is it, it is new to them. It is only now, just recently they have learned it. At that time also, we cannot expect it to be 100% perfectly fine. There might be some issues. So at that time, they are trying, it takes some more time. As a manager, I would be expecting the product to be delivered within 1 month. But since they are new to the technology, it might go beyond 1 month. It might be 1.5 months. So they are trying to find out where are the issues, try to fix them. So those reviews and all inspection that is being done on the test cases that they have written that have been automated. So that the cost, that extra amount which is happening at that time, because I gave billing only for 1 month, but the another half month, that is extra. So that is nothing but the appraisal cost. The product has not been delivered to the client yet, okay? But before delivering to the client, okay, when they are trying to do the testing itself, they need some more time. During testing itself, they are telling, okay, I am using QTP, but I need some more training now also, okay? After the everything training expenses done and all. So after everything being prevention cost expiry, when they are trying to... While validating the product, if some cost is occurring, that is nothing but your appraisal cost. When they have to fix a defect, and that fixing time is also taking more time. So all those things come under appraisal cost.
So Visha, in that case, like the testers will be fitting into this category, right? From the costing yes. perspective?
Yes, yes, sir.
Oh, thank you.
So when I tell you a failure cost, it will be more easy to understand. Let me go ahead with failure cost. Failure cost is nothing but, see, the product has been delivered. Okay, my team, like we have delivered it successfully by learning some automation. Somehow we dragged it for another half month. Okay, so at the end, second month ending, we tried to deliver the product. But somehow it was a little bit complex and one of the major functionality broke down here. Like we have missed one of the major functionality. Now, in order to get that major functionality back to production successfully, the cost that is getting that incurred for that major functionality to work successfully is the failure cost. The amount that has been spent to repair the failure, the major functionality that has broken down in order to get it successfully done, whatever amount that we are putting in so that the product moves into production successfully is nothing but your failure cost. The repairing cost is nothing but your failure cost. But before going into production, whatever the cost, when I was trying to develop myself and do the product, when I'm testing itself, when I'm trying to learn another, suppose during my testing itself, I learned, they taught us automation. But in that automation, I wanted some SQL queries also. So for the SQL queries, I took some 1 week training in between. That doesn't come under prevention cost, because during validating only, I am trying to use SQL also. So that comes under your appraisal cost. There some time has been, they estimated only 1 month, but 1.5 month I took. That half month went for a little bit SQL. So that was your appraisal cost. Okay, now failure cost is nothing but your one of the major functionality broke down. In order to fix that major functionality, again I had to go give the billing to the developer, ask him to develop it. Then again I have to ask the tester to retest everything. I should not only ask him to test the defect, I need to also ask him to do regression testing. I am introducing another term called as regression testing. Okay, regression testing is nothing but whenever there is a defect on the application, we test that defect. Apart from it, we also test the functionality surrounded around that defect. That testing is nothing but regression testing, and the defect which you are testing is nothing but retesting. Okay, retesting, regression testing, failure cost. So these three terms, are you all clear?
Okay, I think we are on top of the hour. I just want to check like whether we are good with the participants. Can we extend it by 10-15 minutes, Visha? And even with the trainer also, I would like to confirm. Can you all please confirm? Can we extend it by 10 minutes more, or what do you feel like? Visha, what do you suggest? Like, do we want to extend, or is it like?
Yeah, another 5 to 10 minutes if they give me also, I would finish off quality assurance and quality control, and so that next session we'll go ahead with the software development life cycle. Another 10 minutes if they give me, it would be good. Hari,
yeah, definitely. I request like if someone really like they don't want extend to call out clearly. Can we go ahead, or does anyone have any concerns around that?
No, I think we can go ahead.
Okay, great. Yeah. Thank you.
Please, I'm okay ahead, with Vish. It.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah. So, Visha, I just have, to simply understand the failure cost. It is something which is incurred after, after the delivery, right?
Yes. Yes,
correct. Yeah, maybe like I will give another simple example actually. For example, each one of us are using the email accounts, right? For example, I will take Gmail itself. So when you log into Gmail, there are different functionalities. You want to send across an email to another person. Okay, so that is one functionality. At the same time, you may want to like send an attachment as part of that email. That is another functionality. Okay, now we have developed the product, and we have released it in the market, and the testing also got completed. But once the product is live, and when the end user started using it, they found that only the email capacity is working, the email functionality is working. End user is able to send across an email to other recipients. But when he tries to attach a file, that functionality is not working. So it is like a very big issue, right? It is something like which is already into the production, and which has been found in the actual live environment by the end user. So such kind of costs which are not found in the very beginning of the testing life cycle, and where exactly like it went into the production live environment and it has been identified at that point of time. So such costs we can classify them as failure costs, because like it was already part of our functionality, but it was not tested properly. Yep. Thank you. Yeah, Visha, please go ahead.
Actually, Visha, I'm so sorry, but appraisal cost also, like, can you give such an example, like, you know, how just Hari gave about Gmail feature, like, you know, attachment being failed after it is.
Yeah, sure, Shirisha. So, just give me a second. I'm just thinking, like, how to give. Okay, in same like what Hari told, like, see, people know, like, they have to attach the files. Give me a second, please, let me think.
Like, if I understand as per this, as per your definition, say, for example, like, you know, something is delivered to the customer, but you know, not everything has been checked. So the unchecked items cause a damage to us. So
Does this damage come under the appraisal cost, you mean? Unchecked, yes. Or untested, say we are talking here in software, untested codes, just in case. So they come under appraisal cost?
No. They will come under the failure cost. Under the failure cost. So if we look into the appraisal cost, what we are clearly calling out is cost of inspection, testing, and reviews. For example, we have built that email functionality. Okay. Whatever the cost that is spent on testing that email functionality or the attachment functionality, that kind of like cost involved around inspection, testing, and reviews, I think like we can categorize as appraisal costs.
Yeah, I got it.
Now. Oh, sure.
Okay.
Yeah, please proceed.
Yeah. So as Shirisha was telling, so untested one will come into failure only. Okay. Untested will not come under your appraisal cost because we don't know it all. We did not touch that at all. So it will, once it goes into production, it will be failed. So it comes as a failure cost for us.
It's Snehal here. So the failure cost is directly related with the failure of testers, right? Because we are failed at test cases.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes, correct. Because we did not test it properly, so only the defect, the product has been delivered with defects. So the amount that is being incurred in order to correct those failures, all those defects need to be fixed. Okay, so that is the failure cost. Now the management has to put in again the same amount of cost for the product to be successful. So that is the failure cost. Okay. Fine. Let me go ahead. I think I requested for another 10 minutes. So I just wanted to cover a few more things here. So thanks for giving me another 10 minutes, friends. Okay. Let me go ahead with two terms, quality assurance and quality control. Okay. These are two terms. Always everybody are confused with it. Okay, let me give you all a clear definition of this. Quality assurance is nothing but it is we are assuring the quality of the product by following some standard processes. That is nothing but our verification process. The term verification, which I have already introduced you all, what we are doing in verification, we are trying to, for whatever step we do, when I write my test cases, I am following the test case template or not. So they have defined it. Whenever you write test cases, you need to use this template. It has to have minimum 80% of positive test cases, at least 20% of the test cases should be negative. There is a requirement, traceability coverage that you need to do. So there are some processes in place. So when we are following these processes, that means we are following quality assurance. That is the QA process. Okay, when we say quality control is nothing but the validation that we are doing. Quality control, we are all QC, we are not QA, we are quality control testers. That means we are testing the application, we are validating, we are giving an input in the UI and validating whether the output is coming successfully or not. Okay, so the QC, we are all QC, not QA. QA is all about processes. QA is about proactively you are trying to identify, means you are trying to see that you are trying to follow the processes proactively over there to ensure that we will try to get a product which is defect free. But quality control, you are intentionally, as a tester, you are trying to give the valid inputs, outputs, and trying to find the defect, identifying the defects. So quality control is a reactive method. Okay, quality assurance is a proactive method where you're following the standards, the testing standards, according to the documentation, you're trying to every step, every process you need to follow. There is a QA process. They don't tell QC process. They tell a QA process, quality assurance process. Okay, so just have in your mind, there are many definitions over here, but always in your mind, remember this, QC, we are the QC people. That means testing. We will try, what are the tester we do? We try to identify the defects. We try to identify and get them fixed. But QA is like we are trying to follow the processes. When we follow the process, we are making sure that the product which we are going to deliver will come perfectly fine. Okay. So QA is process oriented. QC is we are trying to identify the actual testing is QC. Okay. Fine, friends.
So it means that we are challenging the process designed by QA.
No, you are not challenging. We are both, we testers only are QA and QC, but we call ourselves a quality control specialist. QA is nothing but, what I'm trying to tell here is like, you have some standard processes here. Like, suppose I give you one example. When I say you need to have 20% of negative test cases compulsory, mandatorily, you should have 80% of positive test cases. That means when you're trying to do your planning phase, you're not testing in that QA process. QA process is nothing but you have a standard set of rules and regulations that you need to follow these processes. First, as soon as the requirement is given, you need to do the requirement analysis. Once you do the requirement analysis, you need to prepare an ambiguity tracker. That is a process. You need to follow it. That's it. You need to, suppose I tell, no, I will not follow the process. I will prepare somewhere in the email. No, that is incorrect. Why are we telling you you need to have an ambiguity tracker? Because when you are testing, that means when you are doing the quality control, if you find some functionality, you can come back to your ambiguity tracker and you can see, okay, this is what I'm expecting. Did they clarify like that? And if both are same, fine, you will go ahead and pass it. But in the prediction, they will come back and say, no, this whatever you have tested is incorrect. Then you can tell, I have prepared the ambiguity tracker. In this ambiguity tracker, I have clarified this question. As per our understanding, this is what you have given the comment over there. So you have process documentation. Processes are nothing but all the documents or standards that you need to follow. Okay? Got it here? Yeah. Yeah. QC is nothing but your testing phase, your validation. QA is your verification. Each and every step, you have a checklist. Are you doing your review? Are you sending it to your peer review, getting it signed off? Okay. Are you uploading your test cases to the test management tool? Okay. Fine. So just remember, QA is nothing but it's a standard process that we all need to follow in order to ensure that whatever we are going to deliver is a defect-free product. But quality control is your testing phase where you are testing the product in order to identify the defects by yourself and getting them fixed. Okay, in QA process, you will not get them fixed. But QC, you try to identify their defect and get them fixed. Okay. Fine, friends, any questions before I move on to the today almost regarding quality, we spoke about different terms in quality. Now, a little bit, just another 5 minutes, I'll just explain you all two things. One is the requirement document. I will not go to SDLC. SDLC we'll try to cover in the next session with different methodologies. Today, I will just explain you all the types of requirement. Approach. It's not, I will not even explain top down or bottom up. I just explain your requirement, two types of requirement. Is that fine or should I stop it over here? Anything is fine here, please let me know.
Maybe Visha, Hari or Visha, I think we'll close it for today. Too much of anything will be tough to digest also.
Yeah, sure, Hari, I know. It's been almost more than a half.
That is what I wanted to convey, actually. It's a bit
bouncing
hot today.
Okay. I request Shirisha Yadav, who is going to be the host, to stop recording.
Yeah.
Shirisha, may I request to please stop recording?
I'm doing it.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks.